Good morning.
Morning.
last week I said good morning and everyone stood up. we're all used to this now. Good morning and welcome to the Community Church of Chapel Hill Unitarian Universalist, whoever you are, whomever you love. However you arrived at this beloved place, you are welcome here. I want to give an extra special welcome this morning to our visitors, our guests and visitors. If you are a guest and a visitor, there is a special note for you on the back of the order of service that says, welcome guests and visitors, and we hope that you also take the opportunity to check in at the visitors table out in the commons after the service. I want to take a moment as we're getting used to being back in person. I want to take a moment to just go over just a few of the logistics for today. We have sort of two-part seating on the pulpit side of the sanctuary. This is seating for people who are willing to be within, you know, five and six feet of each other. And over on the piano side, the pulpit side, piano side. On the piano side, this is sort of socially distanced seating, and as long as you don't sit on the blue tape, you're fine. And then if we have overflow, the pulpit, kind of busy up here, the balcony will be available as well. Following the service, we will have some water and conversation out in the courtyard. The courtyard is a masked optional space, and then the area behind the Jones Building, where our religious education is held, there's a lawn back there, and there's a porch back there, there's a playground, and that is a masked mandatory. So wherever you are more comfortable. We are not going to be passing the baskets this morning, but there is a basket set up in the back of the sanctuary as you exit, and this morning is a share the plate, so we're going to hear about that in just a second, and we'll have folks holding the baskets as we leave. That's probably better than just passing them around. I think that is all of the logistics that I can think of. And so without further ado, I want to invite up Teri Brooks to do our Share the Plate for this morning.
Hi, my name is Teri Brooks, and I'm here today to talk to you about a project of the Community Service Ministry. This is collecting funds to purchase school supplies for local students. I've been working on this project for 3 years, but our church has been participating in this for 18 years. Just to give you an idea of the need, in 2019, 16% of North Carolina families were living below the poverty line. This included over 2 million children under the age of 18. Poverty level for a family of four, that's with two children, is $26,000. In North Carolina, a living standard income is $53,000. Signs are that those living on such a low income are now in worse shape due to pandemic-related job losses, lowered income, and significant increases in the cost of childcare. Donating today to the Share the Plate directly helps those children and families be more prepared for school. The funds are spent on backpacks and school-specified supplies for elementary, middle, and high school students that have been identified by the school district as in need of this type of support. To make a donation to support this Share the Plate, you can either put cash in the baskets, which will be at the back as you exit, or you can write a check. And in the check in the memo line, you need to write STP school supplies. Due to the need to order the supplies soon, the cutoff is July 18th. Last year, we provided students with over 120 filled packs. We can fill a backpack with supplies for about $16 each. Please feel free to reach out to me if you have any questions I'll be out in the courtyard after the service, or you can look me up in the directory and send me a text or call or email if there's anything else that you'd like to know about this project. I hope that you all give generously. Thanks.
Invite us to open our hymnals to number 346. Come sing a song with me, and I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we sing together.
Something beautiful and splendid. It is perhaps no coincidence that one of the metaphors for building community we find in Unitarian Universalism is the work of weaving. The strands of our own lives come together with all the others in the warp and weft and woof of our lives. Community is created. It is perhaps no coincidence that one of the metaphors for existence we find in Unitarian Universalism is the image of the web, the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. We are each connected to all, and all is connected to us. And so we come together again to realize our place in the independent web, to witness the beauty of our patterns, textures, and colors, to weave justice and compassion into our living. Come, let us worship together. You'll find the words for our chalice lighting in your order of service. If you wish to do so, please join me in reading them. We pause this morning from the chaos of the world to reclaim the beauty within these walls that carry us through our weeks. We lift this community onto our shoulders with pride and grace-filled expectations for our children and our children's children. Please remain seated, and I would ask that you get in a comfortable seated position. As Ginger and George lead us in this meditation through song, it's number 402 in your hymnal. From you I receive. We will wait. You will be singing this short hymn through five times. Ginger's going to do a little retard at the fifth time at the end, so you'll know it ends. And as you sing, follow your breath and let the words fall down into your heart. You can sing the words, you can hum the words, or hum the melody, or you may choose to simply listen to the sounds of the music around you. As you sing and listen, perhaps you might find it helpful and meaningful at some point to close your eyes and picture someone you know in particular. This person, whether a child or adult, is giving to you and then receiving from you. It is good that we can be together in the sanctuary, a community of givers and receivers. Thank you.
Doubling as videographer and worship leader, making sure that our recording is available for those who aren't able to be here this morning. Each week we hold a time in our service for the sharing of joys and sorrows. This is a part of our service where we share the joys and the sorrows of our own lives. How it works is that if you have a significant personal joy or sorrow to share, you're invited to come forward, place a stone in the water bowl, and briefly, in a sentence or two, share your joy or sorrow. We have people usually come down the side, and we alternate sides, and people generally will return to their seats through the center. I was sent one joy or actually one sorrow to share this week. And I'm going to begin with this, and then we will open it. I'm placing a stone for a concern that Krista Westerfeld asked me to share. Krista's mom in the Tampa area went in for emergency abdominal surgery a couple of days ago, and Krista has flown down to be with her. The prognosis is uncertain. And so I've been holding Krista in my hearts, and I invite you all to hold Krista in your hearts during this time.
My name is Mary LeMay, and I have a great joy. It gives new meaning to the concept of church family. Last night at an event at Andrew Wright's home, which was something that I had bid for at the auction last fall, we discovered that we are descended 10 and 11 generations from one of the famous witches of Salem, and we are cousins.
Becky Welks, my husband Chris and I are members here, and our niece Katie Rose Han is getting married next weekend in a small family ceremony in the mountains.
I'm Donna Washington Clibino, and I actually have a sorrow this week. The very first person I know of, her name is Arthretta Martin. She's an amazing storyteller. Died of COVID a few days ago.
We haven't been up here in a while. We forgot the routine. It is really good to be back. But I have a sorrow. Some of you may know Jim Hugerich. He's a dear friend who I've worked with for a long time. He's like a brother to me in many ways. He is in the hospital at the moment with pretty serious leukemia. So I ask you to keep him in your hearts and hope for his recovery. Thank you.
I was fortunate to go to the homecoming ceremony, memorial service, for Billy Lee Rogers, who grew up in the gorgeous community of Chatham County, and I got to know because the community was sprayed with aerial spray by herbicides and severely damaged. We worked with them a long time. She died at 88. It was amazing to hear how many of her grandchildren and children felt she was their favorite member of their family.
My name is Glenn Davis. My family's been a member of this church for back to the 50s, off and on. I share sorrow with you today of the death of Joe Mulligan. Joe Mulligan, several days ago. Joe and I shared virtually no values, no beliefs in common. A difficult person, a Vietnam veteran with post-traumatic stress disorder. We did share one thing in common, and that was the love of my sister Cynthia, who was quadriplegic, and he was an aide and a partner for her for 17 years before his own health deteriorated and he was unable to care for her successfully. So this person, who I share very little with, I still mourn today.
One final stone is placed for all the joys and sorrows that are unspoken, which are held in our hearts. invite you to join with me in a time of meditation and reflection. As we hold the joys and the sorrows, the trials and tribulations, and the beloved memories within this community and in our larger lives, we remind ourselves of that great and mysterious connection known across the human family, that universality binding each and all. We hold in our hearts this morning sorrow and concern for the pains of this world, for all the injustice which we would rise up to challenge, for all the building and rebuilding and saving necessary in times of destruction. We would hold with gratitude the simple joys and pleasures of our living. And we would hold together one great hope, one shared love. Let us hold a moment to connect with the prayers of our own hearts as we hold a time of silence together. I invite you to be still with me. Amen, and blessed be. Right.
call, and I'll be there. You've got friends. Inside a bony ship turned dark and full of clouds.
So choose Annie, Lamott, from her book, Traveling Mercies. Sam was welcomed and prayed for at St. Andrew's Church 7 months before he was born. When I announced during worship that I was pregnant, people cheered. All these old people raised in the Bible-thumping homes in the Deep South clapped. Even the women whose grown-up boys had been or were doing time in jails or prisons rejoiced with me. And then, almost immediately, they set about providing for us. They brought clothes. They brought me casseroles to keep in the freezer. They brought me assurance that this baby was going to be part of the family. A number of the older women lived pretty close to the bone financially, on small social security checks. But routinely, they sidled up to me and stuffed bills in my pocket, tens and twenties. One of the most consistent donors was a very old woman named Mary Williams, who in her mid-80s now, so beautiful with her crushed hats and hallelujahs. She brought me plastic baggies, full of dimes, tied up with little wire twists. When I was at the end of my rope, the people at St. Andrew tied a knot in it for me, and helped me hold on. The church became my home in the old meaning of home, that it's where, when you show up, they have to let you in. They let me in. They even said, "You come back now."
I want to begin this morning with a personal story. I don't always include personal stories, but this morning I'm going to. Almost exactly 20 years ago, in the early summer of 2001, I moved to Dallas, Texas, a place I had never been, to do a three-month chaplaincy internship in a Dallas hospital, followed by a nine-month internship at a Unitarian Universalist church in suburban Dallas. Right after I moved to town, I got a call from the minister of the church where I was to be doing my internship. He had something to tell me. "Thom," he said, "our church is having financial difficulties and we're operating this year with a significant deficit. At our board meeting last night, the board took a vote on whether to cancel your internship to help close that financial gap." It was a very contentious meeting. In the end, the board did vote to go ahead with your internship. The vote was 4 in favor, 3 opposed. A week later, I got a call from the senior minister of the large UU church in urban Dallas. "We need someone to preach this Sunday," she said. I was very confused. At this point in my life, I'd only ever given 2 sermons. And I said, "Yes." And I went that Sunday and preached what could most charitably be described as a good effort. I'm pretty sure I stunk the joint up. After the service, a man approached me during coffee hour. He was a man who stood out. He was just about as Texan can be. I'm talking about a white linen suit, a bolo tie, a silver belt buckle, cowboy boots, and a cowboy hat. We had a brief chat. A few months later, I finished my hospital chaplaincy and went to start my internship at that suburban church. And on my first day at the church, the phone in the church office rings, and the administrator picks it up. "Wow," I hear her say. "Wow." "Wow." She hung up the phone, turned to me, and said, "A member of the urban Dallas church has just called and offered to pay for your internship. He's sending $10,000, and he's also adding in an additional $90,000 to pay down the mortgage that we have on our building." There may be $100,000 sermons. The one that I had given certainly was not. The man who made that generous donation was the man in the cowboy hat and boots. His name was Hardy Sanders. Hardy Sanders grew up in a tiny, tiny town in North Texas. We're talking a 5-hour drive from anywhere. I looked it up on Google Maps and found that it has a population of 923. Hardy went into business as a young man producing corrugated cardboard boxes and did well for himself, made a small fortune. in the corrugated cardboard box business. He came to Unitarian Universalism when his son came out as gay, and this was at a time, the late 70s, early 80s, and a place, Texas, where being gay meant more than likely that you would be ostracized and exiled. You know, stories of parents who have severed ties with children. But the Unitarian Church in Dallas was just about the only institution, the only organization which fully embraced, included, and welcomed gay folks, including Hardy Sanders and his son. When so many responded by severing ties, the Unitarian Church said, here's a knot binding us all together. And so Hardy Sanders would go on to become a major benefactor of Unitarian Universalism in North Texas, believing in the saving power of our faith, a saving power founded and grounded in a rejection of intolerance. And somehow, not that I deserved it, he was one of the people. He was a person who tied a knot for me. This experience, I think, helped shape me in a couple of different ways. I think it helped shape my understanding of churches as places of possibility. Places of possibility. Come to work each day with the understanding that something amazing and wonderful may happen today. It doesn't always take the form of a large financial contribution. There is a magic, though, in meeting. A magic that is possible when people come together. Another related impact this experience had on me was that it oriented me to abundance. I see our church and our community and our world even not as places of scarcity, but as places of abundance. I think back to May and June of this year when needing a rest, why did I need a rest? I scheduled myself for 8 Sundays out of the pulpit so that I could catch my breath. And the worship during those 8 weeks were all led, all the worship services were led by this community. And it was great. We had worship led by the music and religious education program, by members of the preaching practicum class, by Eric Bannon, by ministers connected to our congregation like Reverend Lisa Garcia Sampson and Sarah Bush. What an abundance. And more personally, a third way that this experience at the beginning of my internship 20 years ago helped to shape me was that it modeled a sense of the ways in which the world may hold us. I experienced my faith as holding me, something larger holding me in care, something larger holding us in care. When I was at the end of my rope, writes Anne Lamott, the people of St. Andrew tied a knot in it for me and helped me hold on. Have you ever felt at the end of your rope? People know that feeling. And when you were, did someone tie a knot, help you to hold on? Or conversely, have you ever been the knot? Have you ever tied that knot in someone else's rope? Helping them to hold on through what they're going through. I've seen this community do exactly this for one another. I think about that time I came to church on a Saturday to finish writing my sermon. And in the parking lot, there were a group of church members getting marching orders. Someone in our church had unexpectedly and urgently needed to move out of their apartment and into a new one, and a group had come together, converged to make it happen that day. I think about receiving a call telling me that a member of our church is in the hospital and not expected to survive. And I rush over to the hospital, enter the room, and I find two members of the caring ministry sitting there, accompanying. I think of the youth in our church for whom life is so chaotic right now, but who comes to youth group and finds a few hours of warmth and laughter and respite and sanctuary, finds a knot to hold on to, a knot to hold on to. My sermon this morning is actually pretty simple. It's not a lot of fancy theology. Come back next week for that. I've proved that I'm worth that $100,000. I'm still trying to prove it. My sermon this morning also doesn't require a lot of insightful social commentary, but come back next week for that. I promise it'll be insightful. It's not no political hot takes this morning. I'm saving those for later. My sermon this morning is simply a bit of a love letter to the church. And this church is one of those churches. Because for all the talk of church as a passe institution, I'm always struck by the awareness that there is simply no other kind of community that I know of that seems to be as good at tying knots as a church. May we be the ones when we are hurting to let others know so that they may help form that knot for us to grab onto. And may we be the ones to respond to one another, tying those knots, binding together. Amen. And blessed be. And my sermon this morning really ends with a musical closing. It's probably the perfect hymn that I wanted us to sing. And I reached out to Ginger, and Ginger said, well, we're going to do it up special. So I invite you to join in singing with Ginger and Gray our closing hymn this morning, number 1021 in the teal hymnal, Lean on Me. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit and sing it.
So we'll sing the version that's in the blue hymnal, but at the very end we'll add one more chorus, Lean on Me. Sorry.
Thank you. There is a load you have to bear that you can't carry. Line right up the road, I'll share your load if you just call on me. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long.
Extinguishing the Chalice. You'll find the words in the order of service. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
As we close, or before we close, I want to just take a moment to say thank you for the abundance of musicians who are in the service this morning. So, Jamie Thompson, who's in the members, Ginger Long, our pianist, Trey Brown, on the guitar, George Thompson, helping us out with the hymns. We're going to close with Shalom, which is our traditional closing, and for this note, we would normally do a please rise and everyone hold hands, but we know that in our community right now, there's some people who probably feel comfortable and less comfortable holding hands. So if you're a person who, and we don't want anyone to feel compelled, so if you're a person who would prefer not to hold hands, I invite you to place your hands over your heart. And if you're a person who would rather hold hands, I invite you to put them at your side, and if someone wants to take it, they can take it. So I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we sing Shalom.
Shalom.